Good morning, everyone. It is so wonderful to be with you all on this long Independence Day weekend. Although it's hard sometimes in this time of pandemic to gauge when weekend is, distinct from the weekdays, but this is the Sabbath, and I'm so glad that we're able to be together observing it. And today's the first day that we're kicking off the summer-long series on the Psalms. Today's Psalm is Psalm 91, but I would welcome requests as far as if you have a Psalm. This one was by request, she was the first person to ask me, so I am happy to be able to preach on that and focus the service on that. So if you have a favorite Psalm, please just send me an email or give me a call. Or a text, and I'd be happy to make this part of our July and August series. Just a heads up that the Arlington Farmers Market begins this coming Friday from 4 to 7, and it's going to look a little different, but it's going to be just as wonderful. And we will have a table every other Friday starting the 17th. So July 17th, we will begin. And what we're going to have at that table is going to be baked goods. They all have to be pre-wrapped because of health things. Like, people are going to have to stand the distance. We'll put it out to them. They'll put their money. You know, it's like no touching kind of thing. But we're also looking for, if you're like me, I probably own in the neighborhood of 40 of the kind of tote bags that you get from all sorts of places that you now have to use for in the state of Vermont as of July 1st for all your groceries and shopping. They're no longer giving you plastic bags. You can buy a paper bag, but they no longer, and that's what vendors will be doing. But we thought it would be nice to have everybody's leftovers, and we offered them for free to people, but the people could then make a donation. And Jack doesn't know this, but we're going to make the contributions go to the Arlington Food Shelf. So if somebody wants to, like, take a bag and throw in $1 or throw in $5, that's great. And all that money will go to the food shelf. So if you are able to help us, we need help staffing the table, setting up, cleaning up, and baking for those days. So please consider being a part of our presence. And we really feel it's important to be a presence there and to I'm happy to give a blessing to folks if they come by the table, but we mostly just want to see our neighbors and be with folks and share in the excitement that is the farmers market. Okay, that's it for announcement-y type things. Hopefully you all have a order of worship with you, and we are going to begin on this 4th of July weekend with This Is My Song. Scott's going to play the video for us, and you all can sing along from your homes. And thank you. Let us be in prayer. We are gathered together by the Holy Spirit and the gifts of technology. Though the technology may fail at times, the Spirit will not. Those who are drawn together by the Spirit's power can never truly be apart. They cannot be separated from the love of God or from one another. May we experience the peace and consolation of the Spirit today in our time together. May we be stirred, like the waters at the beginning, into a new creation. May we praise and pray to our God, who is faithful and loving in all times and places. Amen. I invite you now to join me in saying the words that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. I would now invite you, if you have a joy or concern to offer, that you would unmute yourself. And the joy that I would lift up today is for another church. It is the Brandon Congregational Church and their pastor, the Reverend Bill Bartholomew. I'd also ask a special blessing on our daughter, Celine. Tomorrow is her birthday, and my husband and I are leaving today, right after church, driving down to Providence, Rhode Island to visit with her for a couple of days. We'll be back on Tuesday morning. So I'd ask blessings on my daughter, Celine, on her birthday. Others who have joys or concerns, just unmute yourself. And tell me who's speaking so I can make sure I'm looking at you. Anybody have one? Margie?
We have three joys. Our grandson Tyler was 21 yesterday. Our granddaughter Dea will be 23 tomorrow. And our grandson Seth will be 12 on Thursday.
Wow. Great cause for celebration in the Record family, for sure. Thank you.
Kathy?
Diane? Yep.
Yes, just traveler's blessings for my son and his family. They're going to Cape Cod tomorrow.
Great. Remind me your son's first name, Diane.
Josh. It's Josh. And Julie.
Josh and Julie. That's right. Thank you.
Thank you.
Others? Anybody else? Then let us be in a spirit of prayer. Lord God, we give you thanks for all your gifts to us, for daily food, for health, for each breath we take, for freedom to choose, and for the gifts of your word, your power, and your love. We also give thanks today for the blessing of the Brandon Congregational Church and their pastor, Bill. We also lift up and celebrate with those who have birthdays this week, including Celine and Tyler, Dea and Seth. And we pray traveler's blessings for all those who will be on the road this week, especially for Josh and Julie as they travel to the Cape. Our hearts are truly overwhelmed, O God, when we consider how you have entrusted so much to us. May we be worthy of that trust. May we be a people who are unafraid to live as fully and as richly as you want us to live. Help us, O God, as followers of Jesus, to multiply all that you have given us, to risk spreading your word and perhaps see it misunderstood, to gamble by loving those whom others think worthy only of hate, to take chances by doing good to those who have not done good to us. Help us be faith-filled and desire to increase your glory and your goodness in this world. Make us people who share in both word and deed that which you have given to us. We pray for the church gathered today at home and around the world, that it may encourage all of its members to discover, develop, and use all their gifts, those of nature and those of grace. We pray for those who are poor in body or in spirit, for those oppressed and heavy laden, for those sick or in despair. Minister by your Spirit and by us to all those for whom we have prayed, and help us walk faithfully in the path of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. The work of the church continues, and it only does so because of your support. And that comes in many ways. I know folks are very generous with their time, their talent, and their treasure. And I'd like to encourage you to continue to do so. Now we will have a special offering of music from Patty on Eagle's Wings, which Scott will play the recording.
His wings, your refuge.
I would now invite Phyllis to share with us our scripture passage today, our first in our Psalm series, Psalm 91.
I am reading from the Good News Translation. Whoever goes to the Lord for safety, whoever remains under the protection of the Almighty, can say to him, "You are my defender and protector. You are my God, in you I trust." He will keep you safe from all hidden dangers and from all deadly diseases. He will cover you with his wings. You will be safe in his care. His faithfulness will protect and defend you. You need not fear any dangers at night, or sudden attacks during the day, or the plagues that strike in the dark, or the evils that kill in daylight. 1,000 may fall dead beside you, 10,000 all around you, but you will not be harmed. You will look and see how the wicked are punished. You have made the Lord your defender, the Most High your protector, and no disaster will strike you. No violence will come near your home. God will put his angels in charge of you to protect you wherever you go. They will hold you up with their hands to keep you from hurting your feet on the stones. You will trample down lions and snakes, fierce lions and poisonous snakes. God says, "I will save those who love me and will protect those who acknowledge me as Lord. When they call me, I will answer them. When they are in trouble, I will be with them. I will rescue them and honor them. I will reward them with long life. I will save them."
Sometimes safety is a matter of perspective. The one story I distinctly remember hearing from our daughter Celine's experience of her driver's education course at Arlington High School is that if there was a choice about whether to hit an animal or swerve into either oncoming traffic or some obstacle like a tree or a guardrail on the other side, there were only two animals that were worth swerving for. The only two creatures worth avoiding hitting if you were faced with that kind of split-second decision would be a moose or a bear. To reinforce that message, her teacher, Tim Williams, showed them pictures of a car that the roof of it was sheared off from the impact of hitting a moose. And I thought my driver's ed class was scary when our instructor had us practicing on the Northway when I was 16. Worst case scenarios have been a regular part of the daily media coverage on the coronavirus for the last 4 months. Scientists are called upon to make educated guesses about how much worse it might get and how long it's going to last. We regularly witness medical professionals putting on personal protective equipment that makes them appear prepared for a nuclear disaster so as to stay safe while swabbing the nose of someone driving up for a COVID-19 screening test. Such news coverage also has the power to reinforce the idea that as bad as this has been, we are all of us globally, in this together, and that your safety is tied to my safety. Here in this beloved Psalm 91, we have the worst case scenarios laid out in front of us. War, conflict, plague, natural disaster, dangerous animals, and poisonous snakes. Not a lot has changed since this was composed, as Jewish Midrash tells us, by Moses on the day he finished constructing the tabernacle in the desert. part of this psalm is repeated by the devil when he tempts Jesus in the desert. This psalm reflects the writer's belief in a God who keeps him safe and protected. His sense of security comes from God. Have you ever felt that you wanted to pray but couldn't find the words? Something was so big or troubling that just wrapping your head around the feelings and offering them to God alone, who silently seemed beyond your grasp? We can take comfort then from the Psalter, which, after all, is a book of prayers, treasured by so many different traditions. In the Eastern Orthodox tradition practiced by the nuns of Newskeet over the border of cheesecake fame, they pray through all of the Psalms, all 150 of them, every month. In Judaism, this particular psalm is so important that it is recited 7 different times during Jewish burial ceremonies. Psalm 91 reckons with the worst we can encounter and lifts up the God who will not abandon us when the going gets tough. This psalm is sometimes referred to as the soldier's psalm or the soldier's prayer. A mother of 2 sons who served in Afghanistan, Mary Gray was her name, was so reliant on this as her daily prayer while her sons were in harm's way halfway around the world, that she had camouflage bandanas imprinted with Psalm 91 and has sent them at this point to close to 200,000 men and women serving overseas over the course of the last 15 years. Throughout history, this 91st Psalm has been put on small pieces of jewelry and worn as a reminder of the ever-present and never-abandoning nature of God, regardless of evil or danger or disease. Such knowledge is what we need to carry with us now, more than ever, when the simple act of breathing in the presence of others can strike fear in the hearts of calm and rational people like you and me. In this psalm, we travel from a description of the kind of care and protection offered by God at the throughout. And it ends with God speaking words that validate all that the psalmist was feeling. God's protection does not mean that we won't have trouble or pain. It's not that we won't suffer, but rather that those troubles won't have the last word, and they don't define who we are. Here, God is promising deliverance, protection, answers, presence, honor, salvation, and there aren't any prerequisites for any of that. We do not have to earn any of it. It is called grace, and we need only accept it with the same abundance of love that God provides. Nancy Merrill has leaned into the spirit of the Psalms as prayer, and so I'd invite you to now consider this as a prayer of Psalm 91 in her words. Those who dwell in the shelter of infinite light, who abide in the wings of infinite love, will raise their voices in praise. My refuge and my strength, in you alone will I trust. For you deliver me from the webs of fear and illusion, from all that separates and divides. You protect me as an eagle shields its young. Your faithfulness is sure, like an arrow set upon the mark. I will not fear the shadows of the night, nor the confusion that comes by day, nor the dreams that awaken me from sleep, nor the daily changes that life brings. Though 1,000 may deride this radical trust, 10,000 laugh as I seek to do your will, yet will I surrender myself to you, abandoning myself into your hands without reserve. For you have sent your angels to watch over me, to guide me in all my ways. On their hands they will bear me up, lest I dash my foot against a stone. Though I walk among those who roar like a lion or as stealthy as the adder, in your strength will I endure. Because you cleave to me in love, I will deliver you. I will protect you who call upon my name. When you call to me, I will answer you. I will be with you in times of trouble. I will rescue you so that you will know my peace. All through the years will I dwell in your heart as loving companion presence forever. Amen. It is now time that we get to come to the table together. And I invite you to come to a table not defined by wood or stone, but by what rests upon it, which is the me of Christ. Come unto me because any burden is heavy to the one who is under it. Come unto me with the burden of a crowded life or a lonely one. Come unto me with a child's burden of frustration or hunger, of abuse or embarrassment. Come unto me with a burden of grief for the death of a beloved person or a companion animal, for an ability you have no longer or a relationship needing reconciliation. Come unto me with the burden of disappointment, even one that doesn't seem significant enough, or a fear deeper than words. Come unto the me of Christ with any burden, for here is rest for the weary. Lightening of suffering, gentleness, and guidelines for becoming gentle. Here is a yoke of responsibility that can be lifted because of a small piece of bread and a sip of the cup of hope. Jesus noticed that often people ignore both the celebration of those who are dancing with joy and the sorrow of those who are weeping in pain or loss when those feelings are not their own. We come to this table rejoicing with those who laugh and sharing tears of the grieving. We are God's children in wonder and loss, dispersed and gathered at the same time. In your many kitchens or living rooms or decks, rest your hands lightly upon these elements, which we set aside today to be a sacrament. We ask God's blessing on them and on us, and on all those who are in our prayers this morning. Let us pray together. God of the open hand and the gentle yoke, we await your gift and your service. Send your spirit of life and love, of power and blessing upon your children in every house of worship, so that this bread may be broken and gathered in love and this cup poured out to give hope to all. Risen Christ, live in us that we may live in you. Breathe in us that we may breathe in you. Amen. We remember the Creator blessed all creatures and all human beings with plants of the ground and fruits of the tree. We remember that Rebecca's hospitality was proven because she remembered to give water, not just to people, but to camels, and that her compassion shone when she gave more than she was asked or expected. Communion is always more than expected, so we remember leftover baskets of bread and fish, so many parables in which everyone finds a heart-touching story, an invitation to children, tax collectors, and even thieves, hand-washed feet rather than do-it-yourself basin, a holy Pentecost translation app, never the insistence we use special words. We remember the Passover in Jerusalem when Jesus expanded the menu to include himself, a half communion at Emmaus of bread broken. So we still seek the cup in the world, a miracle breakfast on the beach with fish that could feed a village and tables in houses that became church when unconditional love was on the table. Remembering is good, but not enough. Communion is most holy, not in the past, but today and tomorrow, Jesus said. Do this now. Don't talk. Eat and drink. Be blessed. Go forth. let us at many tables receive the gift of God, the bread of heaven. We come unto Christ in the bread we share. Let us in many places receive the gift of God, the cup of blessing. We come unto Christ in the cup we share. Let us now eat and drink of it. In thanksgiving for this meal of grace and in the holy dispersion of virtual worship, we claim the risen Christ's love and gentle yoke are found in all our houses of worship. Let us pray. O Holy One, we have come unto you with our weariness, and we have let go of all in our lives that is heavy. We thank you for the rest and strength of this communion. So now we can lift up all that is light and gentle, humble and easy, and learn from you how to change the world. Amen. Scott will now share the video of Mary playing America the Beautiful, and I invite you to sing together the first two verses. As you go from here, remember the promise of God. I will rescue those who love me. I will protect those who trust in my name. When they call on me, I will answer. I will be with them in trouble. I will rescue them and honor them. So go from here with joy, confident that the love of God and the mercy of God goes with you. Amen. Let us now go in peace. And you can all unmute yourself if you'd like to say any goodbyes or any words.
Thank you, Kathy. That was a beautiful sermon. You
thank
did it
you,
justice.
Thank you, Diane. Your solemn request.
Kathy. Kathy, can you share that interpretation of Psalm 91?
Psalm 91, sure. Yeah, I'd be happy to. It's a beautiful one, yeah. She has a whole book. Every psalm she's taken and kind of, she takes the basic meaning of it, but she adds like some beautiful words to it. So, yeah, I'd be happy to share that with
you. Thank
you. Who was it again, Kathy?
Her name is Nancy Merrill. And the name of the book, it's called Nancy Merrill, and the name of the book is called Psalms for Praying.
Okay, thank you.
And it's really written as a way of praying each psalm. Uh-huh. So it's a wonderful devotional kind of book to use, too. So, yeah.
Carol. Hi.
Hi, Carol.
Hi from South Jersey. Everybody stay
Bye.
Safe.
Bye, Carol.
Hey, everybody stay cool.
Yeah.
Yeah. Have a good week.
Have a good week.
Thank you.
Happy July, everybody.
Yes, you know what you're doing next week by any chance?
I'm doing the 139.
Okay. Good to know.
Yes.
No.
So if you want to be thinking, Patty, about music.
That's right.
Yeah, because I'll be back to work at Wednesday. So.
Okay. And I think maybe this time I'll just sing it live next week. If that's okay.
That's fine.
I think we're yeah.
Okay.
The sound quality might be better. I don't know for sure, but
yeah.
A cappella live, I think it might turn out.
Yeah. Better. And I know there's some beautiful hymns based on Psalm 139.
Okay. So. I'm going to check it out.
Good. Okay.
Bye-bye. Have a
good
Sunday.
Bye, everybody. Bye, everyone.
Have a good week, everybody.
Have a good week, everybody. Bye-bye.
Bye. Bye, Dania.
Hey, Dania. Hey, Landon.
Hi.
Bye, Jack. Bye, Annie.
Bye.
Bye, everyone.
Bye.
Bye, everybody. Bye.
Bye.